Welcome back to Breslov Campus. A new year, the beginning of the Chumash. We start now Parshat Bereishit. Rebbe Nachman has many insights, along with Rav Nosson, on this week's Parsha. To give just one, Rebbe Nachman explains that if you take a look at how many times there are what are called amirot, ma'amarim, utterances, you find in the book of the Parsha Bereishit, and the Lord said, let there be light, and the Lord said, let the waters split, right? Vayomer, vayomer. If you count up how many times in the Parsha it says, vayomer, and Hashem said, and the Lord said, there are 9 times. And the Zohar says that really there are 10 utterances, not 9. But the question is, if you count them up, there's 9, not 10. You see, it says vayomer, vayomer, vayomer 9 times. And the Zohar is making a statement. There's what's called Asara Mamarot. It's not just the Zohar, by the way. It's also a Mishnah in Pirkei Avot, the last chapter of Ethics of Our Fathers, chapter 6. Basara Mamarot Nivra Olam. The world was created with 10 utterances. So the answer is, where's the 10th utterance? So they explain that the Bereshit, the first word of the Torah itself, is an utterance. But the question is, it doesn't say in the word Bereshit, which translates in the beginning or on behalf for the beginning, Bereshit, for the sake of the beginning. There's no indication of an utterance in that word. So they explain that it's what's called Ma'amar Satum. It's really there, but it's a hidden utterance. In the word Bereshit is hidden the utterance for that word, that one of the 10 utterances. So the question is asked, why is that needed? Why can't I just manage with 9 utterances? Because I count as 9. Why is there a need for Hashem to conceal the first utterance called Ma'amar Satum, the hidden utterance, in the word Bereshit? Let it be out in the open. So Rabbi Nachman explains in his very famous lesson called Ayeh, part 2 of Likutei Moran, lesson 12, that these utterances are the source of all creation. But now, if you take a look at creation, there's the good of creation, and there's also the bad. In other words, the ability to have bad exist is also a creation. As an extension, for example, idolatry. Something which goes against totally Hashem, yet Hashem allowed this to exist. It's hard to say this, but Hashem, in a sense, is giving nourishment and life source for idolatry and idol worship to exist in this creation, which seems weird, because this item, this activity, this mind frame goes diametrically opposed to Hashem and His belief, and yet Hashem allows it to exist. To say, God forbid, this doesn't come from God, that in itself is a statement of idolatry, because everything comes from Hashem. Even what seems to be evil is created and formed indirectly from Hashem. So the question is, how could Hashem let that be? Hashem is allowing temples and churches and all types of idol worship to exist, and the life force for everything is coming from God, from the 10 utterances that He used. So how could Hashem allow this to happen? So the answer is yes, it makes sense that it shouldn't happen. It shouldn't come from God. So what it's done is, in a concealed format, in a hidden utterance, from that hidden utterance, yes, Hashem allows for evil and idol worship and belief which goes against God and His service to exist. That's the hidden utterance. Now what that does for a person personally, Rabbi Nachman teaches, is that sometimes a person feels so low, or he does activity that throws him rock bottom. He throws him outside totally of any domain of holiness, of goodness, of anything which is good and holy. And if at that point a person does the right thing, which Rabbi Nachman says is to cry out to God, where are you? Hashem, I am so in the darkness from my situation. I'm so in the darkness from my deeds, because of my actions and my situations, I have no idea where you are in my life anymore. I have no idea even how I'm connected to you. Yet I continue to exist, which means I am somehow indirectly receiving from you, Hashem. So I'm crying out to you, Hashem, where are you? Ayeh. Ayeh mekom kevodo. Where is the place of your glory? Where is your glory to be found in such a low life like me, God forbid, in this situation? When a Jew is able to cry out, Ayeh, where are you, Hashem? Meaning, he recognizes Hashem is there, even though in a situation it goes against Hashem totally. The fact that a person is able and wants to cry out, Ayeh, where are you? He's able to transform this hidden situation where it's being nourished from the hidden utterance into a revealed utterance. Because now that you are crying out, where are you? You are recognizing that Hashem should be here also. And I can't find you, Hashem. I don't know how to come back to you. I don't know how to do tshuva. I have no idea how to get out of this darkness. And I'm asking you, Hashem, help me. The fact that you make this statement to Hashem, now it uncovers. It's no longer a hidden statement. Because now that you're recognizing that Hashem has to be here also, I just don't know how. And I'm crying to search for Him. This opens up the hidden Ma'amar Satum and reveals the hidden Torah. Because we didn't explain this point, the hidden utterance is connected to Hashem's hidden Torah. There's the revealed Torah, which is fit for Jews who follow the Torah to learn. But the rest of the world that doesn't learn Torah, or the rest of the world that goes against the Torah, let's say, or not following the laws of the Torah, they also have to receive from the Torah, but it comes from the hidden Torah. So when a Jew now falls so low and he cries out to Hashem, where are you? He's now gaining his nourishment from the hidden Torah, but now that he recognizes that God must be behind this, it allows the hidden Torah to become revealed, thus helping a person to get out of that darkness. So that hidden Torah, the hidden statement, utterance, becomes transformed into one of the other 9 revealed utterances, thus helping a person come back to Hashem. This, in a nutshell, is the need for a hidden utterance.